It's been said that there are just as many different kinds of feminism as there are women in the world. Tonight's performer is one woman cementing her legacy in the universe. A fiercely independent musical dynamo, Kimberly Nichole is toppling the status quo by breaking the rules. Both feminine and a fighter, this rock ballerina is making her mark on the music business on her terms. Propelled by the rich musical legacy of her hometown of Seattle, Kimberly hit the national stage last year as a lead contestant and ultimately a top six finalist on season 8 of The Voice. She has since shared the stage with a host of legendary performers, from Living Color and Janelle Monae to Jon Bon Jovi and Slash of Guns N' Roses. I'm your host, Tembisa M. Shaka, and don't move because Kimberly is here to give us all of her ladylike rebellion and dismantle patriarchy on site, right here on B-Side.
Yeah.
All right. So, Kimberly, welcome.
Hello.
Please introduce your guitarist for us.
This is GC Castillo.
All right. Yes.
GC!
Tell us a little bit about the song, the name, and...
That song is called Little Girl Knew. I wrote it, maybe like almost 10 years ago. And it was just basically my encouragement song for myself during a weird period in my life. So it's like my swan song. When I think of it and think of getting your heads out of the clouds, not letting the your life get you down, and focusing on your dreams and doing everything that you've imagined you've wanted to do despite what your current circumstances. So that's Little Girl Knew for me.
Okay, right on. So let's talk a little bit about those beginnings. I'm sure it goes back further than 10 years, but tell me about your start with music.
Well, my mother is a pianist in the church, and so she's a singer as well, a great singer. And she always, since birth, my sister and I were always involved in music in some way, in performing arts. We started off in the Angel Choir at Antioch Missionary Baptist Church in Seattle. So my mother was definitely, she's definitely like my idol. She was definitely my first example of being a musician and being a singer and a performer. She also performed in the clubs too, so she was like sacred, secular, you know, mm-hmm. bouncing between the two. The best of both worlds. Yeah. But anyways, so it started with my mommy in Seattle, and you know, the older I got, I was in choirs, and I did musical theater in high school, and then I started writing when I was in elementary school, and you know, it just kind of evolved from there, and then I ended up in Atlanta at Spelman.
Okay, all right. So tell me, at what point you said, you know what, this is what I want to do to make my living, as opposed to this is just something that I'm good at and that I enjoy.
I think as a kid, I knew I wanted to be in the arts. I remember wanting to be like a painter and wanting to be a singer and wanting to be an actress and then a teacher and all this other stuff. But I think as a child, I knew music was my calling and it was what I knew I was supposed to do in this world.
And so who would you say are some of your musical influences?
Oh, so many. Oh, God.
Top three.
Shit. I cursed, sorry. my mother is number one. Oh, God. Of course, Tina Turner and Aretha Franklin, I would say.
Okay, all right. And take us... All right, well, let's see. Are you guys ready to hear another jam?
Yeah.
So we're going to go into song number two from Kimberly Nichole.
Sleep, you got a long way to walk down a one-way street. You better dream while you sleep. Sweet dreams keep you light on your feet. Oh yeah, I'm telling you, baby, we're chained, baby, chained. You ain't winning in this losing game. You better change, baby, chain. You only got yourself to blame. Oh yeah, I'm telling you, baby, it ain't fair. It ain't fair. It ain't fair at all. Down here on my knees.
tease. It's such a tease, such a tease. Going in circles trying to break myself free. Oh yeah, I'm telling you, baby. Oh yeah, I'm telling you, baby.
Tell us a little bit about that one, and then I'm going to let you go right into another one, because it sounds like the crowd is feeling it.
Well, that song I wrote with two good friends of mine, Freddie Stevenson and Rockley, and we wrote that maybe like 3 years ago or so. But it's just, again, about the journey, and it was 3 years ago, me going through something and me thinking about, you know, your perspective on life, and sometimes things really aren't fair. And I mean, that's just what that song is about. It ain't fair. And it's important to be present in each moment. And it's important to rest in each moment and remember your dreams in each moment. So that's what that song is about.
Mm-hmm. Right. And what's the next one going to be?
The next one is called Rosetta Tharpe, the godmother of rock and roll, okay?
Yes.
Which was birthed out of a black queer woman that sang gospel and played a guitar in a fur coat, so that we're clear.
Yes, yes.
All right, this is Rosetta. Yeah.
Color my pictures with a smiley face. Outside the lines, I'm feeling fine. Oh, didn't it rain? You stood before me, bright like a sunny day. You're the prize, the reason why, how it rained. You make my heart go, ooh, yeah. Oh, yeah. My heart goes, ooh, yeah. Oh, well, early mornings, yes, sir, hungover state. I'm so in love, boy, you're the bubble, how it rained. You stood before me, bright like the sunny day. You're the prize, the reason why, how it rained. You make my heart go, ooh, yeah. Oh, yeah, my heart goes, ooh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I wished upon a star for you. Dreamed about a love so true when you came. Didn't it rain? I wake up every morning to you. You're my dream come true. Yes, you came. Oh, didn't it rain? Ooh, holding it right, yeah.
Yes, yes, yes. Yes, indeed. Call forth those ancestors. That's what I'm talking about. Yes. So I want to talk a little bit about this idea that Black women have been making every kind of music mm-hmm. in America. I mean, certainly, you know, prior to our arrival here, but we've been making every kind of music, never limited by genre.
Absolutely.
Right? And you're definitely following in that tradition. So mm-hmm. can you talk a little bit about, you know, being genreless and just being focused on making great songs and making great music?
Well, I guess, I mean, I like many musicians, I just do what moves me, and, you know, I feel like I want to paint with many colors and explore many sounds. Right now, my sound is rock and roll, you know, it's just, it's what's moving me right now in this leg of my journey. But I think that, I just think Black folks, we just can sing anything. Like, I mean, we can do it all, you know, so why not? But,
And at the root, it's soul.
Right, at the root of it is deep-rooted soul. I mean, everything. If you think of every single style of music, it was birthed out of the Black experience. So I feel a natural connection to every style of music, and even, like, country music, it feels like mm-hmm. it's blues, you know?
Right.
Blues was birthed out of Black culture, so... I mean, every style of music just moves me, and then whatever I'm moved to do, I do it, and I do it because I wanna.
Right, and the beauty of being independent is that there's
I can do
nobody
what I wanna
telling
do.
You. Right, there it is.
Absolutely.
So I'm gonna just share with you how I first came to hear about you. A mutual friend of ours, Monique Martin, was, you know, kept telling me, you gotta see this woman perform. She's incredible. She wears tutus on stage, like she's off the hook. I was like, okay, and then it just never happened. And then back in 2011, I saw you on the BET Awards as part of the Music Matters, on the Music Matters stage. And, you know, I remember just being upset that they went to break because I wanted to hear more. I wanted to see more. Like, you were twirling and wailing and just killing it. So fast forward to The Voice. Mm-hmm. I mean, you went on that show and laid everybody out. So talk a little bit about that journey of, you know, getting to The Voice, or, you know, what that whole experience was like.
Right. I think I remember being just totally opposed to doing, like, singing competitions, period. I was like, no, you know, I want to be authentic, and, you know, I don't want people to discredit me. I'm going to do rock singers, go on these shows, it's going to water me down. And then I started, like, writing new music, and I was kind of like, okay, girl, you don't have a deal, you don't have money for a publicist, you don't have a manager, you have overextended your reach. Like, I can't take myself any further. Like, I'm like, this is as far, I've had amazing milestones that I've been able to do with little help and do it myself. Now I've outstretched myself. So what can I do next? And a friend of mine was really like, well, Kimberly, this your generation is a generation of these competitions coming up and being a platform for exposure to kind of help you. It can be a springboard. So why wouldn't you be a part of it?
Right.
So, I mean, the opportunity came where I kind of just went straight to the blinds. I was, like, casted. I didn't have to, like, go and audition or anything. I just went straight to the blind auditions where they turned the chairs. And,
Okay, well, wait. Let's not gloss over that. Why is that? Somebody already knew about you from
well,
the music
I have,
you've done, or...?
One of my dear friends was on The Voice, and then they were looking for more women to cast for The Voice.
Okay.
And so they saw some videos of me, and they were like, we're just going to fly you to the audition.
Hello.
Great, because I didn't want her to go through that whole cattle call anyway. But, okay, I'm not standing in that line.
I got
out already. Okay, look, I'm not going to that line. No, I seriously was like, I'm definitely not. But, the advantage was they already saw who I was. They were like, she wears these skirts. She's clearly, like, she's a rock singer. So they already knew who I was. So there was no, like, them trying to persuade me to be something I wasn't. So the style of clothes I wore was exactly the way I dress on stage. The songs I sang were all songs that are in my wheelhouse that I do. So that was the advantage of them kind of casting me, and they wanted that, as opposed to other singers that may go in there and they try to kind of manipulate or change them into something else that they're not. Like, even from the song they chose me for my blind audition, I didn't even have to give them a song. They were like, Nutbush, City Limits, Tina Turner. I said, perfect, thank you. So it's like they knew exactly who I was.
So what would you say has been the greatest teaching moment from that experience, and then sort of the greatest benefit, the greatest positive outcome from it? Was there something in it where you were like, you know what, I totally got this because of all the things that I've done to sharpen my steel to this point? Or was there a moment where you were like, whoa, I feel like I'm a little out of my depth here? Or
no, I think a teaching moment for me was, you can't really like get caught up in the hype, because then you can be disappointed. And I remember when I first went into the competition, I was just kind of like, I just want to get far enough just for somebody to see me, and I can really expose myself and, you know, kind of catapult my career in a sense. But then, you know, when I started hearing people, their thoughts on where I would end up in the competition, I almost started believing it, and I started playing into the hype of it all. And then when it didn't, the outcome wasn't what people behind the scenes were telling me, it like disappointed me and shocked me a great deal. So it's like, I have to always do my best, and I have to stay focused on the purpose with no real expectations except, and not even think about controlling what happens, because I can't control it. The only thing I can control is what I do. So do my best, and whatever happens is supposed to happen, and don't buy into the hype, because it's BS. And, thank you.
Right, because you're your own best competition.
I mean, absolutely. Like, I can't, yeah, because it was hyped. To the point where the hype can be so great, it can almost, like, sabotage you after you leave the competition, where you're so caught up in the fact that I didn't win, now I'm depressed. Like, what's going on? You know what I mean? So, but it's definitely, like, I have had some incredible, like, monumental, legendary things to happen for me, like performing with Slash with Guns N' Roses, and him, like, becoming a mentor of mine, me being able to call or text him and talk to him about things, and even recently performing with Jon Bon Jovi and Joe Walsh of the Eagles. Like, that's some real iconic stuff, and I didn't even win.
All right.
Well, but who's winning?
Right, you winning right now. All right, so let's hear another one, Kimberly Nichole, winner. Set the song
now?
Up for us.
What is this? Oh, shit. I haven't sang this song in years. So this song I wrote years ago. It's on my album, The Yellow Brick Journey, and one person knows about that here. Come on, Kayla Monte, my brother, Morehouse brother. Glad somebody knows my catalog.
Well, a lot more people know now. So that first album is Yellow Brick Journey, right?
Yes.
Okay, great. Mark
and
that.
This one is called Johnny Come Lately, and I think I wrote it when I was like, one time I was talking to my little cousin, and I just was like, girl, you're just being lazy, you're wasting time, you're fooling around, you're shucking and jiving, you're beating around the bush, girl. So that's where this song comes from.
It was the little things I wanted for you. And yes, oh yes, oh yes, I dream bigger for you. But oh, oh, how I've realized that you can want and you can hope all day, but they've got to want for themselves. Hey, Johnny's been sitting down, fooling around while life's on a run. Sally Sue, she had no excuse for not doing it, doing it. And winter, spring, and summer, fall came around, no getting it, getting it, yeah. But oh, oh, how I realized that you can want and you can hope all day, but she got a want for herself. Straight up to the sky, decisions more wiser. Live out your dreams, life's what it means, more than you think, and you will see.
Shift gears a little bit and talk about personal style and how that has catapulted you in other directions. You caught the attention of one Andre Leon Talley, and that led to one's appearance in Vogue. So let us discuss the slayage.
Well, one thing I love about my mommy is she is a child, baby boomer, and a child of the Motown era. So she was always like, girl, when you get on that stage, you need to look good and sing good and show your legs and put on some makeup and just, you know, look glamorous, because that's the Motown era. Everybody looked good. So the whole style, my style came about, it was just ordained, and it just happened. Not like it was planned or anything, it just kind of happened. So,
Was this a look that you had going on even as a child?
I mean,
were you the kid that picked out her own clothes and was like, guess what? You will deal.
I remember I was a little mismatchy, and my mom let me dress how I wanted to. And I always kind of had a sense of style anyway. But my mom always dressed, and my grandfather and grandmother, they just really stylish people. And then the older I got, I kind of came more into my style. And then I really started understanding style when I moved to New York. And I'm really obsessed with, like, classic films anyway, old black and white films. So I love like an aesthetic, old school aesthetic, and I collect vintage stuff. But like maybe Roxy, when did Jamari and Chimp get married? 7 years ago? Seven years ago, I was at my best friend's wedding, and I remember I didn't know what I was gonna wear for my album release party in Atlanta. And Jamari was like, Chimp's stepmom is an exceptional seamstress. You should have Roxy make you something. So when I was in Seattle for her wedding, I went to a thrift store, bought this beautiful vintage white dress, and I didn't know what to do with it. So I took it to Mama Roxy. Miss Roxy Jones is here today.
She's in the building. Okay.
Tonight, rather. I took it to Roxy, and I was like, Mama, I don't know what we should do. Maybe we should add a petticoat. Maybe we should do whatever, take off the sleeve. She said, okay. She said, oh boy, I'm gonna put some Swarovski crystals in it, and I'm gonna take the sleeves off, and the neck is gonna be high, and then I'm gonna put a hoop in it and add tulle, and ta-da, there was the rock ballerina. It was birthed in 7 years ago. And every single skirt, including this lace leather one I'm wearing right here, has been done by Roxy Jones. We sit down over wine in Brooklyn up the street at her place, and we talk about things we want to make, and she sketches it out, and then she just creates magic. So I wear magic on the stage.
Well, you are magic.
Love you, Mama Jones.
All righty, so tell us about Andre and Vogue, how that...
Well, I have two mentors. Well, the late Nick Ashford and Valerie Simpson. I'm blessed to have, I'm blessed for them to be just like, I call them my musical fairy godparents. But some years ago, they had a showcase for me and invited all their friends in the industry, and Andre Leon Talley was there. So I had on the black tutu skirt, Mama, remember, with the overlay that was like a black and white stripe overlay, and then I had this headpiece with a veil that she made for me, and I had like a Diorse pump on. So Andre was there, and he sat me down, and he was giving me a whole rundown of my look, and he was like, it's very Marie Antoinette, and darling this, darling that, darling this. Who are your people? Who are your people? I'm like, I don't got any people!
Yes, you had Rossi.
So the next day, he called, and he was like, honey, we want you to go down to the Vogue office, and I want you to meet Alexander Couture and bring some of your vintage stuff with you and your tutus. I went down to the Vogue offices when it was down there off of 42nd and Times Square. Now it's at the Towers. And I met with Alexandra Couture, who's a big-time fashion journalist. And she took me into the Vogue closets, which, I mean, the shoes in there, and we tried on some stuff. She complimented me on my waistline. She said, oh, that's hereditary, that's snatched, because I used to be more snatched than this. I've gained a little weight. But I was pulled back then. I was pulled. So what was my inches, Mama? Was I ever a 24-inch waist? Yes, that was when I was 24-inch. Now she's like a 26, so goddamn it. But, so then she paid attention to my style, and let me try on shoes, and then maybe a week or two later, a Vogue trailer was pulling up to my apartment in Harlem, and I was shooting for Vogue in Harlem. The rest is history.
Yes! Yes! Can we get a yes? Yes.
Okay!
All right, so let's do one more song, at least the next one, because I think there's going to be more after this. But I just want to put a little pin in what we're going to talk about after we come out of that, and that will be Seattle.
Is this connected?
Set it up for us, Kimberly.
This is Disconnected. I wrote it when I was in undergrad, and I was in love, and then it ended, and I was depressed, and, you know, the same old story you hear all the time. He left me high and dry. I'm just playing. Not really.
Was he in the AUC?
He was. He went to Clark.
Oh, well, okay.
See, that's what happens when you don't go with a Morehouse band. Sometimes I don't know if they want me or my Morehouse brother, though, but anyways. It's fine. Moving on. Y'all were thinking it, shut up.
My telephone don't ring anymore. Since the day you walked out the door, and oh, the summer's been such a drought. Why am I the one losing out? I gotta pick up the phone. Is it a dial tone? 'Cause no one seems to call me. I didn't say for a rainy day you were supposed to stay. No one seems. Gotta pick up the phone. Is a landed dial tone. Too much of my everything sitting here glooms over me. You lied, just said that you'd never leave. Made you my hope and all of my dreams. you're gone, what's a girl to do? Oh, sit here and moan over you. Hey, gotta pick up the phone. Is it a dial tone? 'Cause no one seems to call me. Yeah, I didn't save for rainy day. You were supposed to stay. Yeah, no one seems foolish. Little girl, you made him your world. Forgot about all your friends, even other men. Footsteps climbing up the stairs. My man's gone now. Ain't no use of listening for his tired footsteps climbing.
About Seattle. Now, of course, you wound up coming to New York via Atlanta, but mm-hmm. let's start in the beginning. So Seattle has a rich, rich musical legacy. I mean, mm-hmm. fierce performing legacy,
yeah.
amazing independent spirit with uh-huh. the artists there. I mean, everybody from Quincy Jones mm-hmm. to Pearl Jam,
yeah.
right? So how was it growing up there?
I had a great childhood in Seattle. It was really, I felt I had like dual energies really inspiring me musically. My parents, all they really listened to ever was like gospel and of course R&B, soul. But then when I was coming up, there was really this big, huge grunge movement happening. So outside of my home, me and my friends, we were listening to grunge music, Pearl Jam, Nirvana, and just we were immersed in it, and it was influencing me, and I didn't really know it was. You know, when something is just a part of the atmosphere, and you're just like, ah, okay, we sing Nirvana and Pearl Jam so much because to get to the black songs on the radio, you have to go through those songs.
It's in the ether.
Right.
And they're being influenced by Jimi Hendrix.
Right. I mean, also, absolutely. Right. So Jimi Hendrix was born and raised in Seattle, and then Jimi ended up going down south, and then ended up going over to London or whatever, but and becoming, I mean, the legend we know him as. But I mean, it was great growing up in Seattle. Some of my dearest friends I'm still friends with from Seattle, but there's a very rich history of music there that people rarely talk about, from Quincy Jones and even Ray Charles. When he left Georgia, he went straight to Seattle and started really hitting the ground in the music scene there. Mm-hmm. So there's like a very powerful energy of black musicians that came out of Seattle that you rarely hear about. But it definitely has, you know, inspired and influenced the artist I've become from. And unbeknownst to me at the time, there was a connection between even my parents only listening to gospel and soul, but grunge, which is an umbrella on the branches of what rock and blues is birthed out of that exact music that I listened to, just like the black experience. So I think I was being connected and intertwined into the musics that I now tap into when I was a child. So it was happening, and I didn't know it was happening when I was a kid there. So.
Did you feel any constraints in terms of your creativity? I mean, you know, it's obviously a fertile place, and certainly, you know, a place that's known for music, right? But there's also not a whole lot of industry influence, not a whole lot of external pressure or infrastructure, right? You know, it's not like it's an industry mecca, and then there's all these people clamoring to go be somebody or go do something, right? They're fine in their creative space. Did you feel that same type of freedom, or was there something that said, you know what, I got to get out of here and do something else, or to take myself to a different place or level?
I don't think I even gave myself the opportunity to feel constrained musically there, because I was so set on moving to Atlanta and going to Spelman. Like, I was leaving Seattle, period. After I graduated from Franklin High School, I was running out of Seattle to go to Atlanta. Like, literally. So I don't think I gave myself the chance to really even immerse into the music culture as a young adult and feel any constraints, because I wanted to have a degree from Spelman College.
Okay, got it.
Yeah.
What dorm were you in?
Abbey Sci-Fi.
Okay, Howard Harold.
Yes!
I was there for one semester.
You were?
I was. I did a domestic exchange program from my alma mater, Mills, because I just needed to have that HBCU experience. And I was already at a women's college, so Spelman was like the natural choice.
Yes,
so,
absolutely.
Yes, I loved my time there.
HH doesn't even exist anymore. It's like a faculty building now. Yes. It's a whole new campus, child.
Okay. All right, so we're going to just skip that. Please take us to how you got to New York.
Well, I remember being in Atlanta, and I visited here. And I just felt this energy and this spirit, like I was supposed to be here. And I just knew it.
Did you know people here when you visited? What brought you here?
No. I was just coming to New York to visit.
Okay.
No, I didn't really know anyone. I didn't at all, as I think about it.
Were you in school still, or?
Mm-mm. This was after I graduated.
Okay.
So I visited New York, and it was really some energy that told me I was supposed to be here. And then I went back to Atlanta, and I kind of started planting seeds and figuring out how I was going to get here. So I had this job working in corporate America. One of my mentors was working at Liz Claiborne and Kate Spade and Juicy Couture and that whole umbrella of Liz at the time. And she was like, well, Kimberly, they're looking for an HR assistant for the offices in New York. I went up and interviewed. The guy hiring loved me. And like maybe a month or two later, I was in New York and living in Harlem, where I wanted to live, in a nice apartment on Jungle Alley. Jungle Alley is the historic street during the Renaissance where the Cotton Club was.
Oh, so wow.
When I moved to New York, there was an energy too pulling me here. And I feel like I was placed in Jungle Alley for a reason, because there's still like a strong spirit there. I was next to Bill's place, where Billie Holiday used to perform as well. So it just fell into place.
Wow.
Just,
So what was your degree in, and was that connected to your job, or?
No, my degree was in economics, but okay. I did HR because I had internships in HR, so I just kind of fell into it, and then I just had good jobs from it.
And then did you just start gigging right away since there was all this musical energy around you?
I did. I was in Atlanta, and I kind of started doing open mics in Atlanta, and people knew who I was, and I remember just putting feelers out there like I'm moving to New York. And so musical friends of mine started connecting me with people in New York, and then I started, as soon as I got here, I was like performing and stuff.
And was there a place that sort of was your spot to stretch and work out and jam? Or?
Yeah, open mics on Sundays, Ron Grant and Friends at Village Underground.
Okay. And where was the party that Andre
it
met
was at
you
Ashford and did his Sugar Bar.
Oh, Sugar Bar. Okay. Yeah. Nice.
Yeah. So we're singing now.
You're like, you're feeling my energy, because I'm like, all right, so we're about to transition back to more singing. So,
is this the last song?
We'd actually like to get two back-to-back if possible. So, okay, well, wait. One now and two at the end.
Wait a minute. No, haven't I done like five or six songs already?
Somebody's going to have to count. You've done five,
little.
So there's one more.
Little.
Oh, you did four.
Little, Rosetta, Johnny.
See, this is our way of trying to milk another
fair.
Song out.
Disconnected.
We feel
last
it.
What? I mean, we can do another, but more. Y'all want me to, Ro?
More.
Yes.
More.
Yes.
Okay.
Do we want more?
More?
We want more, audience. Sounds like we want more. Yes, we got Rosetta Tharpe. We heard that. Yep. Is there a cover you might want to bless us with?
I mean, I was going to do, the last song was going to be a cover.
Oh, okay.
Okay, that's fine.
We're going to try Chase on this.
Let's do, let's just do you, Nothing Compares. Do you remember? No. Let's do Roadhouse Blues. Okay, fine. We're going to do a song by one of my favorite rock bands, a blues band, basically. Okay? Oh, keep your eyes on the road, your hands upon the wheel. Oh, keep your eyes on the road, your hands upon the wheel. Well, we're going to the roadhouse, we're gonna have a real good time, yeah. Back at the roadhouse, I got some bungalows. Yeah, back at the roadhouse, I got some bungalows. And that's for the people who like to go down slow. Let it roll, baby, roll. Let it roll. Soul, all right, yeah. Roll, 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 thrill my soul, all right. Ladies, give up your vows,
give up your house. Hey, save our city. Save our city right now. I woke up this morning. I got myself a beer. I know some of y'all had a beer this morning too. And I woke up this morning. I got myself a beer. Ooh. Hey, we're going to the roadhouse. We're gonna have a real good time. Let it roll, baby, roll. Let it roll, baby, roll. Let it roll, baby, roll. Let it roll all night long. Yeah.
All right, so Kimberly Nichole, you've got a new album coming, right? Let's talk a little bit about that. Because now, you know, you've whetted the appetite for those of us watching who may not have been familiar, who may not have seen The Voice. Now, they're open, so
I mean, it's a work in progress. No release date yet, but I'm writing
it. And you have a title?
I do.
For now.
It's called The Lonely Bones right now, but... You know, I'm just writing. I don't know what's going to happen. And then I'm moving to London, so then who knows what's going to happen with that and there. So,
you know. Okay. You're doing a Jimi Hendrix move.
I sure am.
Like Seattle, UK. Let's do this. Now, what brought this on? Was it Brexit? Were you like, okay, no, everything is going to be a little cheaper, so let me bust this move?
No, I've always wanted to get to London. I just feel... It's one of my favorite places, and I've always thought, after New York, where do you go? You go to London. So I'm just going to see what happens. And hopefully it's something phenomenal happens. I know something will happen. I feel it in my spirit. I get the same feeling that I did when I moved to New York. So
yeah, I see things just gravitating towards you and all kinds of creative collaboration happening. And, you know, good, bad, or indifferent, when you go to Europe, it's astounding how much they know about black music.
I know.
And how much they appreciate the history.
Absolutely.
And, you know, you'll be able to.
And they get it.
Yeah, they get it. They're not going to be trying to turn you into some crazy Pop-Tart who is like unintelligible. Like, what?
Right.
Right. So.
Absolutely. So I'm excited to bring my tutus and the rock
and
ballerina.
And get your twirl on.
And back bend and squall on the British people. Cheerio! Top of the morning. I'm playing. This is so wrong. Okay.
Well, we wish you the best out there. We know you're going to kill it. So give everyone your social media so that they can follow you, find you, connect.
Twitter is at Kim Nicky, KimNicky. Instagram is Kim Nicky. Facebook, Kimberly Nichole, and KimberlyNichole.com. So NICHOLE, Kimberly, KimBerly, NICHOLE.
Get that H in there. That H, yes. Give it up for Kimberly Nichole, everybody. Yeah. All right, so regrettably, tonight's musical mutiny has come to an end, but Sister Kimberly's uprising will continue. You know that. Thank you, Kimberly Nichole, for providing us with this musical insurgency. Be sure to pick up her new album, The Lonely Bones, whenever it is released. Wherever you buy or stream music. Yes, we have to support the music we want to hear. And you can join her sonic revolution on Instagram, the Twitter, the Facebook, the online, all that. I'm Tembisa M. Shaka, and I hope you've enjoyed this time with us as much as I have. Be sure to stop by our Brick House studio every Thursday to hear more of the best music Brooklyn has to offer. You can also check out tonight's installment and past episodes anytime at youtube.com/BrickTV. All right, Kimberly, you know we want one more, right?
Yeah.
Take us out with another performance, but right after this. Thank you.
Orleans. There is a house in New Orleans. They call the rising sun. And it's been a ruin of many a poor boy. And God, I know I'm one. Taylor. She sewed my new blue jeans. My father was a gambling man, all down in New Orleans. Is a suitcase and a trunk.